Morning, Your Honors. May it please the court, Kathleen Zellner on behalf of the appellant Ray Spencer and also the Krause appellee. So this case has a long history, and I want to focus on the fact that a JMOL was denied after the verdict. We had a 17-day trial, 2 days of deliberation, many opinions prior to the trial denying the summary judgment. So the trial court determined after the verdict and after briefing after the trial that the Devereux standard that had been set on the continuing investigation prong of Devereux, when the investigator is held to a standard of knowing or should have known that the suspect was innocent, was almost an impossible standard to meet. And that the district court said, unless we have direct evidence that someone's innocent, and that would be difficult to have in a child abuse case, then it's difficult for this court to imagine, the district court, there could be ever be sufficient evidence to show that the investigator knew or should have known that the person was innocent.
So in Kostanich, we said Devereux was circumstantial. Was it for circumstantial cases? And here, was there direct evidence of fabrication that was presented to the jury?
Yes, there was. I was a trial attorney. I ended up reading 320 quotes to the jury that I contended were fabricated and that the witnesses testified were fabricated.
So doesn't that take us out of the Devereux context?
Yes. And I think, you know, Devereux was a 2000-2001 case. I believe that Kostanich advanced the analysis to a much more tenable conclusion that you could have constructive knowledge from the fabrication itself. So if an investigator is fabricating, in this case, hundreds of quotations, that from that you can deduce that you have a constitutional violation without anything else.
So is your position, I think this is correct reading of Kostanich, but I want to make sure. If someone fabricates evidence against a defendant, even believing that they're guilty, that's a constitutional violation.
Yes.
You may have problems farther down the road on causation of damages.
Yes.
But at least the constitutional violation is the fabrication of evidence. You don't have, as long as you knowingly fabricate the evidence, you don't need any more mens rea than that.
I agree with the court that is the only position that's consistent with the Constitution, with due process. You cannot be saying, oh, you can fabricate if you think the person's guilty. Because the accrual time is when the fabrication takes place. It's not at some retrospective point later. But that's the key point. The key point is, at this point, according to the trial judge, there's a standard that's impossible to meet. So you have carte blanche to fabricate.
Well, it isn't actually impossible to meet. It seems to me that even under the court's standard, the court may have been incorrect, because once you have the testimony of the alleged victims that they were not in fact victims and that they told the investigator that at the time, then that supports the finding under the jury instructions that were given that the investigator should have known at least.
Right.
So you may be right theoretically, but I'm not sure that it matters to the outcome.
It may not, Your Honor, because I do think that our evidence was sufficient to establish under the Devereux standard that the defendant, Krause, knew that or should have known that Mr. Spencer was innocent. This case was fabricated from the very beginning out of whole cloth. There was absolutely nothing. And then in addition to that, this defendant concealed the exculpatory medical records of two of the three children. The third child never had an exam done. Two of the three children, those medical records were concealed. The videotape of Katie Spencer, the defendant Krause took home and had in her garage for 20 years while Mr. Spencer languished in prison.
Let's assume you have ample evidence to go to the jury of fabrication and wrongdoing. And speaking only for myself, I think you do. Case is a little strange because your client pleaded, did an Alford plea, but pleaded. Normally we look at a trial and say, oh my God, had the jury known this stuff? What do we do with that here?
Well, you have an Alford plea, so you don't have...
He didn't admit anything, I understand.
No, exactly, but that's important. So you don't have him admitting anything, but you do have him testifying to the fact that he entered the Alford plea because he was presented with the fabricated police reports, and he believed that he had absolutely no chance to prevail at trial, plus he was broke.
Is it possible in a case like this to move the causation meter back slightly in time? In other words, there seems to be ample evidence here that two prosecutors, when presented with all of this evidence, said not enough. A third prosecutor said yes. Had that prosecutor known that much of the evidence was fabricated, isn't there a good argument that he never would have been charged in the first place?
Exactly, because if the prosecutor who actually went ahead and filed the charges had no hands-on involvement in the case, so he didn't interview any witnesses. It's not like a McSherry prosecutor. He didn't interview anyone. He didn't have the videotape because it had been removed and put in the defendant's garage. And so he was strictly relying on these fabricated reports. One of the really fascinating things about the case is we presented exhibits to the jury showing them the quotations that each child remarkably had used the same language, identical quotations. So the four-year-old had used the same language as the five-year-old. The four- and five-year-old had used the same language as the nine-year-old. And so I think it became apparent to the jury from the very beginning that there was deliberate fabrication in the case.
Let me ask you a precise factual question. Is there evidence that, and I know we have Big Matthew and Little Matthew, but is Matthew Hansen, is there any evidence that his statement was fabricated?
Yes.
What's the evidence on
that? Okay, here's the evidence of that. It's because Matt Hansen said he had witnessed the sexual abuse of Katie and Matt Spencer.
Each of whom denied that it took place.
Each of whom had denied. And so even the trial judge at the summary judgment stage said that that was really the key point with Matt Hansen, that there was still evidence that his reports were fabricated, in addition to all the special deals that had been offered to him with his criminal infractions and all of that, which I think I was able to impeach him in front of the jury. But that's the key to the fabrication in his report. He's witnessing their abuse. And then, of course, his medical report, which is concealed, shows no abuse of him.
Could you also address the district court's alternative ruling that there was an error in the jury instructions and that the moving force instruction didn't capture the Section 1983 tort causation principles?
Yes, because the trial court was very involved in the jury instructions, drafting them. And so we all agreed that the moving force instruction was the causation instruction for this cause of action. And then it was only subsequently that the defendants in a reply brief started raising issues. Well, maybe we should have but for. But all of those arguments are waived. All of those arguments on but for were made about having probable cause for the false arrest, malicious prosecution, false imprisonment, which I dismissed so I could just take the case to the jury on deliberate fabrication. But going back to the moving force, that is the causation instruction. It applies to individual defendants.
I thought that was for Monell. When I looked at the mild jury instructions, that was for Monell claims, and then also that's from language in one of the Monell or one of those decisions. So does that capture for individuals both actual cause and proximate cause?
No, because it's been, the moving force has been applied to individual defendants. It was in Johnson versus Duffy, Kahn versus City of Reno, and I think Harper versus City of LA. The court is correct that the typical case where you see moving force appears to be a Monell claim. But as Judge Settle said, and it's in footnote 6 of his May opinion, you know, if that wasn't the instruction he should have been using, the comments are very misleading about it. But
is it more? Let me just, yeah. If we could rank causation.
Right.
Obviously, but four is the least amount of causation you require,
yes.
Because the next level up is proximate cause.
Yes.
And there was a proximate cause instruction in this case.
There was.
Where does moving force fall on that scale? Is it more than proximate cause or less than proximate
it's
cause?
It's more because it's the moving cause.
Okay, so if it is more,
right.
Whether or not it was correct or not, it posed a higher burden. If it was incorrect, then there should have only been a proximate cause instruction, right?
I'm sorry.
If there is no requirement of proving moving cause in a case involving an individual, then the court should have only given a proximate cause instruction, right?
That would be true, I think, if it had only been applied to Monell, but it's been applied.
But no, I'm asking, let's assume that it only applies to Monell. My point, I think, is that that couldn't have harmed the defendant.
No.
Because it imposed a higher burden on you than if it weren't given, the appropriate instruction would have simply been a proximate cause instruction, right?
Yes.
And so
Your
why
Honor,
is
to
that?
Correct,
Could
to
you explain that? I mean, we've got these two words, moving force.
Right.
Opposing counsel argues that that's more akin to a substantial factor.
It really isn't.
And why isn't it? I mean,
well,
substantial factor says it's one factor in the cause.
Yeah.
Moving force is one force in the cause.
It's the moving force. It's the use of the word the. It's the moving force. Because, and I have to correct myself, counsel submitted a proximate cause instruction. We did not. We simply had the moving force instruction.
But approximate cause instruction was given.
Yes. So going back to that, in the proximate cause instruction that the defendant submitted, they, of course, put into the instruction that there could be more than one proximate cause. Okay? So in our moving force instruction, it was simply this is the moving force.
Well, counsel, I guess I have the same question that Judge Hurwitz asks, and that is, if there was error, I don't see what effect it could have possibly had, because the argument of the defendants was essentially, as I recall it, there were intervening causes, such as the Alford plea, which was referred to in an earlier question, and that argument was made already. I mean, under the existing instructions, that argument was available and it was made because it goes to either proximate cause or moving force. So I guess I don't understand what difference it makes.
I don't think that it does. And what's fascinating about the closing argument of defense counsel is he uses moving force synonymously with intervening cause. So what he tells the jury is the real moving force of this was, you know, the prosecutor's decision to prosecute. The real moving force of this was the Alford plea. The real moving force. So he used it synonymously with intervening cause. So I don't see that it makes a difference. I do think what's important.
Basically, the argument was it was too attenuated from the alleged fabrication.
Yes, exactly. That the fabrication was just so clear and overwhelming. And I think the jury, I mean, this was a 17-day trial. This is what we were doing. They were presenting intervening causes. We were arguing the fabrication caused him to enter the Alford plea. The jury decided credibility. It heard all of these people, both of the defendants, it heard all of them testify, and it concluded in our favor. There had been a deliberate fabrication and that the defendants had been indifferent to the violation, and that Mr. Spencer, who spent almost 20 years incarcerated on this case, the longest in Washington history.
But could you, if we were to agree with you on moving force, and so then we have to write an opinion, in this context, moving force means, what would we say?
You would say that moving force encompasses cause and fact and proximate cause. It's legal cause and it's factual cause. And it was the model.
You know that. I mean, moving force doesn't really mean much of anything. So what does that mean?
If you're right, then we ought never give a moving force instruction. We ought only give a proximate cause instruction. I go back to my point that I think it didn't prejudice the other side in this case. But if you say that moving force is just a combination of but-for and proximate, then why give it at all?
It was just sort of plucked out of a Supreme Court opinion, right? So I'm just trying to translate that into actual
legal English.
Well, I think you
have to look at the instruction that was given, because it wasn't just thrown out, this is the moving force. If you look at instruction 21, it says that the jury, that the criminal charges, now this is on the moving force, filed against plaintiff were based on that evidence. Plaintiff suffered injury as a result of this evidence. The evidence was so closely related to the deprivation of plaintiff's rights as to be the moving force that caused the ultimate injury. And because defense counsel argued their whole defense was their intervening causes, I don't see the objection to the moving force. I just don't see that it makes any difference. It's harmless error if he should have called it proximate cause. But I think it's actually stronger because I think that, you know, but for somebody becoming a police officer, you know, things may not have happened. This is, I think, a higher and stronger standard. But regardless, what difference does it make at this point? The jury heard, you know, all of counsel's arguments about intervening causation. We covered that. We had such detailed instructions. And then on top of it, our verdict form, the jury had to, in the verdict form answer, I think it was 7 questions, and they had to go through whether or not there was deliberate fabrication, the Devereaux standard. Then they had to continue on the supervisory liability. And then was the violation of plaintiff's constitutional rights to due process of law the moving force in causing the damage? So this was such a carefully managed case with, based on trials I've done all over the country, this was very carefully managed. The judge, I think, at the end of the day, was concerned about, I think he misinterpreted Kostanich. He thought it only applied going forward. And
counsel,
it was just a mistake.
Did you want to reserve any
rebuttal
time?
Yes, I should stop talking. Yes, I could reserve. I think I have 2:27 left, so thank you.
You do.
May it please the court, I'm Jeff Frame, and I'm representing defendant Michael Davidson.
Could you speak a little louder or raise the...
Sure.
Make you raise the podium up a little.
Okay. May it please the court, I'm Jeff Freiman, representing defendant Michael Davidson. I'd like to reserve 5 minutes for...
For your co-person?
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
Got it.
Yes.
I thought you were going to ask for sir rebuttal or something, but my mistake.
Yeah, I misspoke. Judge Settle wrestled with the parameters of Devereaux liability for over a year, through dozens of motions in this case, through 15-day jury trial. And in the final analysis, he concluded that there was insufficient evidence for a reasonable jury to conclude that police detectives in 1984 would have known or should have known that Mr. Spencer was innocent.
And I understand he wrestled with that and we're wrestling with it too. The question is whether or not it matters whether they knew or should have known that the plaintiff in this case was innocent.
I think,
in other words, is it your position that as long as the defendant is guilty, the police do not violate the Constitution by fabricating evidence?
Our position is that the en banc court in Devereaux stated that
I can read what courts state. I want to know what your position is. Is it your position that there is no violation of the Constitution if evidence is fabricated as long as the defendant is either guilty or the police believe he's guilty?
That's not only my position, Your Honor, but that was also the position of the en banc court in Devereaux.
So you think that, let's say it's a bank robbery, and you are pretty sure that X is guilty, but you for either because you're lazy or you can't find the evidence, you make up the eyewitnesses who don't exist and you plant evidence, and that's okay because you know that he's actually guilty?
It's not okay. The issue
is it a violation of due process for the police to do that? Yes or no?
No. It would not be a violation of due process under the court's ruling in Devereaux.
Is that consistent with Kostanich, what you're saying now?
It's consistent with part of Kostanich. When the Kostanich court was analyzing the liability of the supervisors, it did apply the issue of whether they knew or should have known that the a foster parent was engaging in misconduct. It wasn't a criminal case. But
well, there may be different issues with regard to supervisory liability, because in my scenario, it's possible that the supervisor wouldn't even have reason to know that the material has been fabricated. But that wasn't really the question. It was the question of fabrication itself. And it's your position that it does not violate due process to make up fake evidence if you think that a defendant is guilty.
Again, Your Honor, I believe that is my position, and it also was the clear statement by the Devereaux Court.
Well, but here we have, and let me give you a hypothetical that's not this case. Let's assume we get to trial and Detective Krause takes the stand and says, yes, I made up all this evidence. I did it because I thought he was guilty, and I was afraid there wasn't enough evidence to bring charges in the absence of me fabricating some. I know that didn't happen here. Your position is there's not enough, that case does not go to the jury because she did not believe he was innocent?
If there was no other evidence to suggest that there was knowledge of innocence, then yeah, it shouldn't go to the jury under the Devereaux standard. It does not rise to a constitutional violation.
So let me play out my thing, because I find this position astonishing. The detective takes the stand and says, you know, I heard and I believed this guy was a molester because I just looked at him and he looked like one, but I didn't have any evidence. So I fabricated all the evidence that was used at trial. He was prosecuted and convicted, and it later turned out he was innocent. But I am not subject to liability because I truly believed he was guilty. That's what you're telling me, so I want to make sure that's your position.
Okay. That's a little different hypothetical, I think.
Well, no, but it's tell me the answer to the hypothetical, and maybe okay. I can decide later if it extends back to your position.
Okay.
Under that hypothetical, is there an actionable 1983 violation?
There would have to be some evidence to support guilt. I think that you can't just say, I'm going to make up everything.
Well, you said it's the detective's detective's belief. She has to believe that he's innocent in order for there to be a cause of action.
If I said subjective only, then I misspoke, objective,
okay,
too.
Okay, now, fair enough. So let me change my hypothetical slightly. One witness comes forward and says, this guy's a child molester. And the detective says, I believe that witness, but that's not enough to go to trial. It's just not very, very good. So I'll make up a whole bunch of stuff to make sure he gets convicted. She truly believes, and there is at least some evidence of his guilt. And she takes him to trial, and he's convicted, and no 1983 violation, even though she admits fabricating the rest of the evidence?
I think what you're missing, Your Honor, in that hypothetical, is subjective belief isn't enough liability.
I'm now taking your view that subjective belief isn't enough. My question is, even if she had objective reason to believe that this defendant was guilty, you're telling me the Constitution does not prohibit her from fabricating evidence. That's your position.
I am telling you that objectively, regardless what the detective thinks.
Now, if there's objective reason to think that he committed these crimes, you're telling me the police are then free to hook up the rest of the case to make sure he's either convicted or enters a plea. That's your position.
That is my position,
wow.
And that is what the Devereaux Court said, Your Honor.
Let me just ask you about this. I mean, when I read Devereaux, it said, we're persuaded that there is a clearly established constitutional due process right not to be subjected to criminal charges on the basis of false evidence that was deliberately fabricated by the government. That's our statement of law in Devereaux.
That is the first prong.
And then we go on and say, here's how you can prove it in this case where there's no direct evidence of fabrication. There's just aggressive interviewing. So Kostanich said that was the approach that you use for a circumstantial evidence case. Why would that be applicable in a case where there's direct evidence of fabrication given our statement of law? This was our statement of law, the constitutional right not to be prosecuted on the basis of false evidence that was deliberately fabricated by the government.
That's the constitutional right, the first prong of a qualified immunity analysis.
And the second is, should it clearly, would a reasonable officer have known it? we thought, yeah, that's pretty obvious. A reasonable officer would have known that. Mm-hmm. So I don't see how that helps.
Well, then the court went on to explain that at a minimum, in order to prove a constitutional violation of that right.
In a case where there's no direct evidence, as we said in Kostanich and explained, and in Devereaux there was no direct evidence, correct? There was just aggressive questioning of these child witnesses.
Yes, that is true. That was the allegation in Devereaux.
And you agree there's direct evidence of fabrication in this case?
We don't concede that, Your Honor.
Well, you don't concede that she did it, but surely you must concede that when a statement is presented from an alleged victim that says the victim said A, B, and C, and the victim then takes the stand and said, no, I didn't. I never said those things. That's direct evidence. How persuasive it is, given ages and time, is a different issue. But surely that's direct evidence, is it not?
In this case, the trial court, I think, correctly analyzed what did the police officer know at the time of this investigation.
I'm asking whether there was direct evidence of fabrication in this case.
Based on the testimony of two of the three child victims, they allege 30 years later.
No, understand, weight of the evidence is a separate issue. There was direct evidence of fabrication, was there not?
Yes.
So then, given Judge Akuta's question, don't we go back to Kostanich, not Devereaux, where we're trying to, there's no direct evidence of fabrication in Devereaux. We're looking at aggressive questioning, and we say, gee, you got to show more than just aggressive questioning. But do you have to show more than just direct evidence of fabrication to get to a jury?
Oh, it got to the jury. You know, the summary
judgment. Well, no, in this case, but the judge granted a JMOL, so.
Yeah, oh, okay.
I mean, the fact was I shouldn't have sent it to the jury.
Yeah, right.
So that's my question. What if you have direct evidence of fabrication, and put aside the two-page, seven-page statement that may or may not be direct evidence of fabrication, but you have two people who take the stand who say, a detective produced a report that said I said this, I never said it.
And it didn't happen.
Could you have more direct evidence of fabrication than that?
I think this detective had yet another victim. I mean, we're talking about two of the three victims. A third victim has never recanted, testified at trial.
And that's why I asked the question. So let's assume she says, well, I think he did it against Matthew Hansen, I guess, right? The later victim. And your opponent says, no, there's evidence of fabrication on that, too. But let's assume she truly believes that he did all this stuff. But there's direct evidence that she fabricated much of the case. Don't you get to the jury under those circumstances? You can argue causation and intervening cause and everything else, but surely that states a constitutional violation, doesn't it?
If the objective evidence shows that there was no objective basis to
you're saying you don't get to the jury under my hypothetical.
Yes, I am, because there are two elements. There's the element of deliberate fabrication, proof of that. In addition, and both parties proposed this instruction, Your Honor.
Well, I don't care who proposed what instruction. I'm trying to figure out what the law is.
The law is, in our eyes, that there is an element, you have to prove deliberate fabrication. That is not the be-all, end-all. If you prove that, you don't win. You have to prove the next element of knowledge of innocence, objectively or subjectively.
We do have some case law suggesting that when we're looking at essentially the sufficiency of evidence to have supported the jury's verdict, which is what we're looking at here, that the instructions pass out of the picture, and if they were wrong, we don't have to just look at what the instructions said. And as I have the same reading, I guess, of Kostanich, where we said that that Kostanich in that case had produced evidence supporting the claim of deliberate misquoting and misrepresenting the statements of witnesses, and that was sufficient to win. We reversed a holding very similar to the one in this case. So regardless of the instructions, don't we get there simply with the fabrication evidence itself?
I say no, not only because of Devereaux, but also because even the plaintiff in this case agreed.
Well, I understand that. That's why I'm saying that our job isn't to worry about what the plaintiff agreed to or what the instructions were. Don't we have to look at the evidence at the trial against the correct legal standard and regardless of the instructions?
It's a JMOL.
Yes.
The judge said there wasn't enough evidence to go to the jury. Forget how the jury was instructed for a moment. Don't we have to determine whether there was enough evidence to go to the jury?
I do think you have to determine the amount of evidence was sufficient to go
right.
to the jury. But
there may be error with the instructions, and you have arguments about that. But we don't look at the instructions to figure out whether there was sufficient evidence to go to the jury, do we?
I would agree. You have to analyze whether the jury had sufficient evidence under the applicable law.
Right, right.
Yes.
So let's say that, assume for the moment, that this sort of due process claim, there is not an element of showing that the officer thought or should have known that the defendant was guilty. Let's say this innocence prong of Devereaux is not an element. Then was the district court wrong in its JMOL? So if I understand your case, it hinges on the question of whether the innocence prong is an element of the case, an element of the deliberate fabrication due process violation.
With all respect, Your Honor, I think that would require me to speculate how the judge would have analyzed this.
If the innocence prong is out, there is no, under Kostanich and the way we've described the rule of constitutional law of deliberate fabrication, there's no requirement of showing that the police officer knew that the defendant was innocent. That innocent prong is not part of our law. Let's just assume this for a moment. Does that mean you lose? Does your case hinge on this innocent element being part of the test?
I think it would have changed our approach on appeal. I mean, in this case, we were seeking affirmance of the judge's ruling, which was based on the objective evidence of knowledge of innocence.
So Judge Acuda says, assume he was wrong in saying that. Is there any other basis on which you can defend the JMOL?
I think if...
Or must we reverse?
If that were the case, we would have put a lot more emphasis.
Well, but it doesn't matter what you would have done.
Well, I mean, you're asking me to speculate.
No. I'm asking
you. What is your argument that, in fact, the district court was correct and that the jury did not have sufficient evidence to find in favor of the plaintiff if the innocent element is out of the picture? What would your argument be?
In that case, our argument would be that there was insufficient evidence of deliberate fabrication at the time. You have to remember that there was evidence in this case as to both of the people who are claiming fabrication that they'd said, I did tell the detective that. They said that under oath twice for Matt Spencer.
So for a JMOL, we would have to say taking the evidence in the light most favorable to the non-moving parties or to the winning party, yes. And so would you be able to argue that even taking the evidence in the light most favorable to the verdict, that there wasn't enough there?
We would attempt that argument,
Okay, thank you.
Judge Settle didn't rule on that basis, though, right?
That's correct.
And we can look at that ourselves and determine whether there was sufficient evidence to go to the jury.
Certainly you have that authority.
Let us hear from Mr. Bogdanovich.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you.
May it please the court, my name is Guy Bogdanovich, and I represent Sharon Krause in this matter, who's present today. I want to address the pointed questions about the state of the law. Devereaux has been and continues to this day to be the seminal case that is cited in this circuit for the cause of action known as deliberate fabrication of evidence. And to answer the court's questions, Kostanich, in our opinion, simply didn't address the issues we were wrestling with in this case about the second element, which plaintiffs proposed a jury instruction on and we proposed a jury instruction on.
That takes me back to my original question. Let's even assume that the instructions were correct. There are two of the alleged victims who testified these things did not happen, and the statements attributed to us by the investigating officer are false. Why isn't that sufficient for the jury to find that not only deliberate fabrication, but also that your client should have known that there was no ground to believe that he was guilty?
Well, I think that your last statement there, with all due respect, Your Honor, kind of pulls the knowledge of innocence element back into it. But to address
right,
the,
that's why no, she, I did that on purpose.
She's
saying,
even assuming there is a knowledge of elements,
right. Why isn't
there
evidence,
enough evidence here right. to get there?
All right, my apologies. And again, I go back to because Devereaux.
No, I'm asking a factual question now. I'm not asking a legal question. I'm saying assume the instructions were correct. Why isn't there enough evidence to support the jury's verdict under the instructions that were given, assuming that they were correct?
It's for all of the reasons that Judge Settle relied upon in granting the judgment, notwithstanding the verdict.
Well, but I don't understand that. Well, I'm giving you Devereaux now. Let's assume Kostanich never occurred. The entire world is Devereaux. And you have to show, you have to produce sufficient evidence to go to the jury that a reasonable officer would have thought whatever you think Devereaux requires. Okay. We have here two people who say she made up our statements. When we talked to her, we told her that it just didn't happen. Isn't that enough, even if only the Devereaux standard applies, to get to the jury?
No, it's not. And I would cite language from the United States Supreme Court, which I think partly addresses this. And don't get me wrong, the cases are consistent in condemning police conduct along the lines of fabricating evidence. And if you're asking me, I wholeheartedly agree with that. But what the United States Supreme Court said in Hartman, which we've relied on heavily in support of our but-for causation instruction, excuse me, they said it may be dishonorable to act with an unconstitutional motive and perhaps in some instances be unlawful, but action colored by some degree of bad motive does not amount to a constitutional tort if that action would have been taken anyway. And that
but
gets...
That's the causation argument.
That is a causation
argument. But
that's not the
question I think Judge Graber asked you. Maybe, she's much better at asking it, than
well,
I
that's
am.
Okay. I think we understand your position, so...
Okay. And I would like to address the causation element because...
The time has expired. You may briefly...
Right,
My comment
on causation is that the Hartman case is critical to a situation like this where plaintiff's entire case was trying to prove the unconstitutional animus by Detective Krause, yet she wasn't the person that made the decision that by all accounts caused these damages, caused the imprisonment. That was done by the prosecutor's office
I know Judge Graber is told you to finish up, but I have to ask this question. So let's assume the facts in the light most favorable to them, which is that Detective Krause made up some of the evidence. And then she brought it to a prosecutor who said, hey, that looks like enough evidence to charge to me. Are you saying that she's immunized from liability because she lied to the prosecutor too?
No, I'm saying you have to look at all of the evidence that was in front of the prosecutor, which started with his direct testimony was the unsolicited disclosure by Catherine to her mother at the time.
No, and I've read what the prosecutor said, but surely the prosecutor didn't say, had I known that a lot of this evidence was fabricated, it wouldn't have made a bit of a difference to me. I would have charged him anyway.
He did not say that. He was not asked.
No, he was not asked. So the jury was surely entitled to infer that had the prosecutor been told the truth, these charges would not have been brought.
Well, and that's the problem with the causation instructions. I strongly disagree with plaintiff's counsel's representation that there was a proximate cause instruction given. There never was. And there were five questions on the verdict form, the last of which is, did the fabricated evidence cause the damages or something to that effect? There was no discussion of a but-for, no discussion of you have to take out whatever you found was fabricated. And keep in mind, there was very direct evidence that twice under oath, these two recanting witnesses at trial as adults, one of them had said, I reviewed those reports and I told Detective Krause everything that was said in there.
Thank you, counsel.
So you have to take all that.
We will take all that and all of the arguments that everyone has made. You have a bit of rebuttal time remaining. Thank you.
Your Honor, just so it's clear, when we were addressing the proximate cause, I said that both merged into the moving force instruction, but I believe that the proximate cause is incorporated. But setting the instructions aside, there's case law all across the country that states that even if there would be probable cause found, that a officer still cannot fabricate evidence after that. And so I think to propose that just because an officer thinks someone is guilty, you can just go ahead and fabricate, carte blanche to fabricate.
There may be no damages, of course. If there are, 11 eyewitnesses plus one fabricated thing, it would be impossible to demonstrate that there was either causation or damages, but there still could be a violation.
Right. And I agree, Your Honor. And I think the other thing that's very telling in this is Judge Settle, the only reason he entered the JMOL was that he didn't think Kostanich applied to this situation. He thought he misinterpreted the language going forward, which applied to the civil proceedings, the child custody proceedings. It was just that fundamental mistake that made him shift positions from when he denied the summary judgment motion. He denied the JMOL at trial on this, so it was just a misreading. But the most significant thing that Judge Settle said in the May opinion is there was vast amounts of fabricated evidence in this case. This case went to a jury. That's what we have juries for. What counsel's talking about are just credibility determinations. This jury decided that the two children, who are now grown-ups, were truthful. And they decided that the third victim, Matt Hansen, was not truthful. They made those credibility findings, and obviously, this court doesn't want to go back and make credibility findings or try to reweigh the evidence. So this JMOL should never have been granted. The positive thing about having it granted is it's the opportunity to look at some of these standards, like the Devereux standard, or maybe, does there need to be a knowledge of innocence standard, or is the act of fabrication, does that indicate that one knows that someone's innocent? Why do you have to fabricate against a guilty person? Why would you be doing that? So I think those, and maybe that's in part, I try to think that Judge Settle, up to the last opinion, gave very reasoned opinions that he wanted to force this issue and get a decision on it by a higher court. So I thank you.
Thank you, counsel. The case just argued is submitted, and we appreciate very much the arguments of all three counsel. They've been very helpful to us.